You honor and glory tonight. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm glad to be here. I really am. I'm glad to be here. I never want to take God for granted, never take his word for granted, his love for anything that he does. Amen. Because he's rich in mercy and grace. So I asked the Lord, I said, well, what do I share with them tonight? So since I didn't get to share it Sunday, we get to share it tonight. Praise God. Hallelujah. So the title of our lesson tonight is What to Do When You Don't Know What to Do. Chris said you couldn't have made that title no longer. What to do when you don't know what to do. You know, the times that we're living in right now, we're bombarded with decisions. Should I take this job? Should I quit this job? We have endless choices. Is this the college for me? Is this the guy or the girl for me? Excuse me. Is this the church where God wants me to be? And sometimes we just flat out have no idea what to do, what to choose, and how to make the best decisions. But if we trust God with our lives, that means we can trust him with the choices and decisions that illumine over us. We can trust that if he has a best case scenario for us, he will lead us toward that choice. Part of the way God does that is how? Through his word. So when I was asking the Lord, I said, well, God, when we don't know what to do, what do we do? And he gave me four nuggets of gold. I call them nuggets of gold because they eternal and they outlast trouble, trials, whatever. First one was, he said, you stay in the word. You stay in the word. You just keep doing what you know works. And the word always works. The word is incorruptible. It is the seed of God. It's not dictated by what season. It's dictated by your believing. Anybody can plant the word of God. This is the only thing that is guaranteed to reproduce every time. Every time the word of God is guaranteed to reproduce in my life. And we were just having a monologue while we were sitting at the table. And the Lord was just saying, he said, you know, any time that the word does not seem to be working, the first place that people usually look at is at God. Like, you know, well, maybe it's not God's will, or it's always God's will to prosper us, to heal us, to save us, to deliver us, and to set us free. It's always so. It's never God. And he told me that day, he said, it's never me. He said, because when I had it written, that was my heart, and I've never changed it, and I'll never change it, and I'll never go back on it. So if the word of God does not seem to be working, you stay with it. And the first thing that a lot of believers do when things start going contrary or haywire in your life or doesn't seem to be lined up, the first thing we want to do is close our Bible and quit going to church. You ask some folk, why ain't seeing you in church? Child, I've been going through. You can't go through without the word. You cannot go through without the word. The word of God is the compass for our life. It's the direction for our lives. And if we don't have that, then we don't have anything. Because when the enemy came to tempt Jesus, he said, it's written. What was he referring to? The word. It's written. So a lot of times when things start, like I say, going, seem to be blowing up and not working in our lives, first thing we want to do is shut God down. That's the last thing you need to do. And you need to just go back in your mind and think about times that you've been up against the wall before. And we all have that testimony in here. We've all been up against the wall before. We've always prayed, and perhaps it didn't turn out like we wanted it to turn out. Or we've all been in hard places. We've all been in bitter places. And the word is what brought us out. So he said, no matter when it doesn't seem to be working, stay with the word. Because faith comes how? And hearing is a continual, ongoing process. It's not a once in a while thing you do. It's a continual, ongoing process. Remember I shared with you all that the Lord told me, he said, yeah, you might be out of college, you know. You don't have to write papers and you don't have to take a test. He said, but this is not the time for you to go back to TV. He said, you still need to give my word priority. He said, there are things I want to show you, revelations I want to reveal to you, ways I want to show you to be more effective in the kingdom, ways that you can believe me more for the word, because the last test we had is not the last test we're going to have. I don't know where we as believers got the idea that once we made Jesus Christ the Lord of our life, you know, that everything's going to be smooth sailing. Well, it wasn't smooth sailing for Jesus. So if it wasn't smooth sailing for Jesus, it's not going to be smooth sailing for us. But when Jesus was on the earth in his ministry, he tested and proved the word. So he knows it'll work. You know, just like a car manufacturer or whatever, before they'll put a car out and put their name on it, release it, it goes through a lot of rigorous testing for what kind of oil, what kind of tires, what kind of weight, all that. And when it meets the specifications of that company, they put their name on it and then they release it. Well, God's put his name even above, you say, I put my word even above that of my name. So his word is good. All you got to do is go back through the word and look at his track record. It's good. God's track record, he never fail. He will never fail. His word will always do what it is supposed to do. Now, sometimes where we begin to doubt the word is we put our eyes on people that we consider to be spiritual. You know, they're just spiritual. They're in the word. They love God. But no, we should never put our eyes on people to validate whether the word of God works or not, because we don't know people's hearts. God does. And there are a lot of people that are not experiencing the fullness of the word of God. And it could be a lot of different reasons. You just may not know enough yet. The timing might not be full or ready for it to come forth yet. There may be unforgiveness in a person's heart. There may be rebellion in a person's heart. You know, we don't know. Only God knows the heart of a person. That's why God tells you to keep your eyes on his word. That's our standard, is the word of God. So when you don't know what to do, you stay with the word. Because look over there. God is not a man. He told me, he said, anytime you sit down to read my word, study my word, I want you to always put that scripture in your eyes. Because sometime when you read what the word says that we are to have as believers, our lives may not be lining up with that. But if you stay with it, it will line up. It will come to pass. You just believe God and it shall come to pass. So he said, you just got to you stay in the word. Go with me to James chapter 1 and verse 5. I don't know about you, but I've been in places that, you know, needed to make decisions and, you know, just kind of like, ooh, I really don't know what to do about this. You know, I don't know if I need to stand still or move to the right or move to the left or go forward or whatever. So, you know, and that's when you just go to the word and you see God in prayer and you ask him, what should you do or how should you handle this? So James 1 and 5 says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that give it to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be. It shall be given unto him. Now, wisdom is the ability to work the word. You can get the word, but God will give you wisdom. That means he'll give you the strategy and the know-how of how to work that word. God can give us a word. God can give us a word, and then he'll show you how to work that word so that it can bring the desired results. He said it shall be. He didn't say it might. He didn't say it was a possibility. He said what? It shall be. That's pretty firm. He said it shall be given him, but let him what? Ask in faith. And faith comes how? And hearing what? So the only way you can ask in faith is you got to know what the word says. He said, but let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double minded man is unstable in all his ways. See, when you begin to vacillate back and forth, that's what wavering. When you begin today, you believe God's a healer. Tomorrow, well, I'm just not sure. So that you're wavering. There's doubt in there. You're vacillating back and forth. The fact that it hasn't changed does not change the word. You take the truth of the word and you change what you see. And so you have to stay in the word so that it will keep you from wavering. You know, the word of God is an anchor. It will just anchor you. Have you ever seen, like, they tell them a storm is coming or whatever, and the boat starts reeling and rocking and all that stuff, and you'll see people go out and they tie down the boat to keep it from being blown away. That's what the word will do. If you will put that word in you and keep that word going in you, that word will hold you steady in the midst of a storm. It'll hold you steady in the midst of a trial or a hard place. It will anchor you. Amen. And the word of God is sure. But he said we have to ask in faith. You have to ask, trusting and believing. Trust the character of God. Because God can't lie. He don't lie. He won't lie. And it says, if you are double-minded, if you're wavering, don't think you're going to receive anything. Now, is that in y'all's Bible? It said a double-minded man is unstable in all. It didn't say some, did it? In all his way, a double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. So when you don't know what to do, you stay with the word. Don't throw away the word. You stay with the word of God. The word of God will hold you steady. There's been times even in my own life going through certain things. If I had not known what the word said, I would have fainted. I would have given up. I would have thrown in the towel. I would have lost hope. But the word of God gave me hope, because I know that God can't lie. He don't lie. He won't lie. And whatever he said, he keep his word. He'll never fail to keep his word. When we're not faithful, he remains faithful. And he's in covenant with us. He's a covenant-keeping God. He'll never break a covenant. He'll give you a better one. But he won't break his covenant. He said, I won't alter the word that have gone forth from my lips. So the first one is you stay in the word, you stay with the word. Now we say that, but that's not always easy to do. You have to make a decision. I'm going to spend time in the word, because if you don't, you'll look up and your whole day has gone and you're like, oh my God, here it is 10, 11. And then you're thinking about, well, what I got to do tomorrow and all this. And just like you haven't had time to put, but when you go day after day after day without putting the word of God in you, it's like driving your car day after day after day and not paying attention to your gas hand. Ain't nothing wrong with your motor. Ain't nothing wrong with your transmission. Everything else is working fine in the car, but for some reason or another, you stuck on the side. It cut off, and you're stuck on the side of the road. And it's simply because you didn't gas up. And a lot of us are stuck. And when I say us, I'm not just talking about us in here. I'm talking about the body of Christ at large. Because we don't know the significance. Oh, there we go. We don't know the significance of the word. We don't know the power of the word. We don't know the necessity of the word. And we just have not. Job said, I esteem the word more than I do my necessary bread. The word of God is our life. I mean, it is a light. And it can shine in your life in the darkest of times and lead you out. He said his word is a light unto your path, and it'll be a lamp unto your feet. It'll show you what you're standing in. And then that light will go ahead of you and show you the direction in which you ought to walk. So when you don't know what to do, when you don't know what to do. Now, some people say, I always know what I'm to do. Well, you got it better than me. You're smarter than me. I don't always know. There are sometimes decisions have kept me up at night. Praise God. So, no, I'm not going to say. Now, I say, I always know what to do. That's my faith statement. But it's according to the word. But in and of myself, no, I don't always know what to do. So he says the first thing is to stay with the word. And this bears repetition. When things go wrong, the first place people stop going is to church. I ain't figured that one out yet. Because, well, I'm going through. Well, wouldn't it be better if you're going through to have somebody that know the way? Can help show you, because you there and you blind as a bat. You don't know the way. You don't know how to go out. So you're going to stay at home or wherever when you can come into the house of the Lord. And God has put a word there and the light's there and somebody could help. But that's the first thing you do is just you just stop coming to church. You just stop reading your Bible. Well, the Bible don't work. Why doesn't it work? One thing Dr. Cahill told us, he said, why are you reading the Bible? It's reading you. What does it say? Amen. So the Bible says don't be double-minded. Just stay with it. Say, Lord, you know, this situation here confronting me. Father, I just don't know what to do. I need your wisdom. And he said, if any man lack wisdom, let him do what? Ask of God. God, I need your help. I need you to show me how to handle this. You know, what do I do, Father? Is this the way I should go? Or is this a good deal or not? Every deal that sound good ain't good. And see, the Holy Spirit will lead you and guide you and direct you. And one thing I did learn, and I learned from the Word, but I also learned from Pastor Taylor. He said, you go anywhere and they start putting a lot of pressure on you to get it now because this deal ain't going to last but 3 or 4 days. He said, let it pass you on by. Let it pass you on by. And he said, if you go in there and you want that bad, he said, leave it. Walk away from it. And if it's still with you in a few days, after you, then go back. But don't let that pressure of that moment, you know, make you make a decision which you haven't used wisdom, and it will cost you plenty. I've experienced I've experienced that. It will cost you. But that's the first thing we do when we don't know what to do. You stay in the Word. Word is our peace. Word is our joy. It's an anchor. It has helped me so many times. Just that Word. Just the Holy Spirit opening my eyes and giving me more and more understanding, more and more clarity on the Word. And it will hold you. The next thing is to guard your heart. You have to guard your heart. You cannot just let any and everybody talk to you. Now, God will always give us somebody we can talk to, somebody that you can confidently confide in and it will stay there, somebody that loves you and have your best interests at heart. And so you have to guard your heart. You have to guard what you look at. Guard what you listen to, because it will have an effect on what you believe. You got to guard your heart. It said with all things. Let's look at Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6. The Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So it is so important what's in us in abundance. If you got the word in abundance in you, guess what you got in abundance in you? Faith. Woo! And faith, that's how you please God. That's how you receive from the kingdom, is by faith. You were saved by faith. Filled with the Holy Ghost by faith. Healed by faith. Made righteous by faith. Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6. Everybody there? It says, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Be not wise in thine own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. I said, Father, since I went through seven. But trust in the Lord with all your heart. That's keep you from wavering. A divided heart. Your heart has to become one with God. Don't lean to your own understanding. I heard one person say, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. Because God knows what's right for us. He knows the direction we should go in. Some of us think we're so off course, but you're not. You're really not. You're closer than you even believe. You're closer than you even think. But he said, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. Don't be a person that think you know everything. Don't nobody know everything. Now, you might know a good bit of things, but you don't know everything. Somebody can teach you something. Even children can teach us. So he said, don't lean to your own understanding. Some believers are so etched in religion, tradition, even the word of God can't even change their minds. You know, and it takes the Holy Spirit. And he said, all your ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct your path. He knows the way in which you ought to go. I've never been anywhere where I had to have a tour guide. But a lot of people go to Israel and other places, and they have a tour guide. Well, they didn't just pick somebody off the street and tell them to take you on a tour. It's somebody that is familiar with that place. Who's more familiar with God than the Holy Ghost? Ooh. Say, he knows the mind and the thoughts of God, and he will take them and he will show them unto us. So we've got a tour guide, and his name is Holy Ghost, or Holy Spirit, whichever one. And when you allow him to begin to show you the will of God for your life and the purpose of God for your life, it'll cause you to hold steady instead of, you know, and I call it spazzing out all over the place, you know, and your emotions are just under vicious attack. You know how emotions can get under a vicious attack. When you're going through a hard place, the enemy wants to harass and torment and attack your mind. He doesn't have access to your spirit. Thanks be to God. But he will try to do a number on your mind. He will show you why this isn't going to work, how you've been disqualified from this and disqualified from that. But I read the book where he said he would not be wroth with us, he would not be angry with us, that he would cast our sins as far away as from the east, from the west, and he'll never remember them anymore. Ooh, now I don't know about y'all, but that helped me. Because I was just sitting there and I was just telling God today, I said, God, you have covered me. You've never exposed me. You know, and you've been there. You've led me and you've guided me and you've directed me. You chose me. You anointed me. You appointed me. You called me. And God, I just thank you. I just thank you for just loving me. I'm telling y'all, when I got a revelation of God's love for me, and it's growing, I don't have the fullness of it, but I got enough of it to keep me on the high. And while I'm supernaturally wonderful every day, pain try to come, I'm still supernaturally wonderful. Money try to act funny, I'm still supernaturally wonderful. Things go on in the family, I'm still supernaturally wonderful. That's my decision, because I know how much God loves me, and no matter what happens in my life, it's me and him. And he's proved himself faithful. He's a bad God. And he has proved himself faithful. I mean, I'm telling you, you can't push me so far to the wall. Because he's between me and that wall. He's that rock. He's my solid foundation. And I know that. And even when I miss it, and even when I blow it, and I repent, he just washed me in that blood. We just keep it moving. We just keep it moving. And I just thank God so much for that. So we have to guard our hearts. You have to protect your heart. Don't just let people release and speak anything over you. God has already named you. He said you're his beloved. He said you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. He says you're the redeemed. He says you're the healed, filled, full, and free. He said that. He said he would supply all I need. He said that. Let him name you. We'll allow other people to name us. And the worst thing you can do is try to measure yourself against somebody else. When God made you, he didn't pull the last one he made. Let me see. I made her eyes blue. I think I made her. No. Every one of you is a unique design of God. There's not another one like you on the face of the earth. The giftings and the talents and the things he put in you is necessary for this world. So, you know, he made you original. Don't die a copy. I look at all these people. It was a young lady, and she came up on YouTube, and I don't know how many surgeries she has had trying to look like Barbie. She's had ribs moved so she could have that little tiny waist and all this stuff. Now, God don't make no mistakes. So every time she alters something on herself, she told God he didn't do a good job. He doesn't have any trash heaps. That's not where he got the stuff he made you of. You came out of him. He deliberately, specifically, took his time making you. See, some of us just got to get that so we can learn to love us. You got to get to a point where you know you're enough. You're enough. Just because somebody else don't see your worth, it just means they don't know value when they see it. You don't let, because they don't think, what do you think? So you got to guard your heart against all those kind of, from the enemy, from naysayers, from just, you know, and sometimes people make statements to you and they're really not trying to hurt you. They just say stupid stuff. You know, and you have to decide how you're going to let that affect you. Some of us start out on a beautiful day and somebody say something, your whole day shot. The devil is a lie. I read the book. I'm enough. Glory to God. So you got to guard your heart. The third thing he told me was increase your praise and worship. And we did that Sunday. Well, I have to tell y'all this. Sister Sharon Watts called me Sunday evening, and she said, Apostle, she's believing God to get that poured out of her chest because it's been giving a lot of pain. They got her arm back working, praise God. And she said, she said, when you pray for me, she said, And I was sitting in the house today, and I was listening to the praise and worship. That's when y'all see me on the phone. I'm putting praise and worship up when they pray. And I put it out on Facebook so she can see it, and it'll bless her, whatever, and whoever. We get so many hits. People really enjoy, you know. We got to get that camera and stuff back there where we can get, where we can go live. I've had so many people say, why aren't you live? Why aren't you going live? So we're going to get that going. But anyway, she said, I was sitting in there and prayed. She said, and after that, she said, all of a sudden, it's like a fresh wind came through the house. And it just sit right down on me. And she said, every bit of pain left my chest. And, you know, we sent that word to her Sunday morning. She said, Apostle, the only way I could tell you is like a fresh wind. It just came right in my house. And she said, it just sit right down on me. She said, I began to praise God. I said, oh, God, my lifeline family, praying for me. She said, I knew it was the Holy Ghost. I'm like, God, I have to remember to tell them that. So we have to learn to increase our praise and our worship. I gave you all, let's look at Galatians 6 and 9. God good, y'all. He's faithful and he's just, and the half ain't been told. Galatians 6 and 9 says, and let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Let us not be weary. Don't grow tired. Don't throw in the towel. Don't think this ain't working. I need to try to find something else. No, stay with the word. For in due season, God's appointed time, we shall reap if we faint not. And where we faint? We faint in our minds. God doesn't want you to faint. That's why you have to keep your mind and your heart full of the word of God. It will keep you from fainting. Don't get weary. Don't give up. I know it looked like it's been longer than it should have been. Amen. But just stay with it. Stay with it. Stay with it. The word will come forth. Amen. Philippians 1 and 6. Philippians, and I gave that one. The Lord had me to give that one Sunday before we left. Philippians 1 and 6 says, being confident of this very thing, that he which have begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Being confident of this very thing, that he which have begun, not finished, which has begun a good work in you will perform it until Jesus comes to get us. Isn't that wonderful? You can be confident of that. And that's why we can praise and worship God. Being confident. Having that inner boldness to know that God's going to do exactly what he said. There are some people that you know that if they give you their word, you can take it to the bank. You can it's as good as done. It's solid. Because you know their character. You know their integrity. And they have a track record. And all through the Bible, God's track record is good. He's a covenant-keeping God. He said, even when Israel wasn't faithful to me, I was faithful to them. And so God is always going to be faithful to his people. Look at Hebrews 10. Verse 23. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. God said, you got my word on it. But my word to fail, I would have to cease to be. And you know he's never going to cease to be. He said, hold fast. And the reason why you have to hold fast to it, because there's an enemy arrayed against you trying to take that word. He's trying to steal that word, because if faith come by hearing and hearing by the word is the seed which produces faith. So if I want to see to it that you don't have a harvest, let me get the seed. He's after the word, because the word produces faith. So if I can get the word out of your heart, then that's the seed that's going to produce a harvest of faith. So he said, let us hold fast the profession of our faith. The last one's watch your mouth. The last nugget's watch your mouth. You can't just be running off at the mouth. You can't just say everything you think. As long as it's a thought, it can't produce. But when you open your mouth and release it, then you just gave either the kingdom of darkness or the kingdom of light permission to go to work on what you just said. That's how much authority we have in the earth. That's how much power that our words carry. Psalms 34 and 12. Well, let's look at verse 1 first. Psalms 34 and 1 says, I will bless the Lord when his praise shall what? Be where? In my mouth. In my mouth. My soul shall make her boast. It didn't say my spirit. It said my soul shall make her boast in the Lord. The humble shall hear thereof and be glad. I will bless. I will. That's an act. That's a choice, a decision on purpose. I will. That's why when we come in on Sunday morning and we get into praise and worship, and as an act of your will, you bless the Lord. We don't bless the Lord because everything is going the way we want it to go. We bless him because things are as good as they are. And when I bless and praise it, it draws his provision. It draws his help. It becomes a magnet. And it turns things. It sets things aright in my life. Because what I'm telling God is, before I even see it, I'm going to bless you. Before it even manifests, before I even have it in my hand, simply because your word said it is so, I will yet bless your name. I will extol you. I will esteem you. I will exalt you. I will praise your name with tears running down my face. Maybe my body's shaking, but I will to bless the Lord because you inhabit the praises of your people. So I'm going to bless you. I don't have to see it. All I got to know is you said it, because you are a God that cannot lie. You're a covenant-keeping God. Number 12 says, what man is he that desire, we're still in chapter 24. What man is he that desireth life and loveth many days that he may see good? How many of us want to see good? Well, let me tell you how you do that. Keep thy tongue from evil and thy lips from speaking guile. Watch your mouth. You can't just shoot off. You just can't just say anything. Because you put things into motion when you start talking. Because God's sitting on the horizon looking at this darkness and everything, the Holy Ghost hovering, the power, the muscle of God, hovering over this dark, uninhabited place. And it was just there. He was there. But until he opened his mouth, nothing happened. Till you open your mouth, ain't nothing going to happen. Either good or bad. A lot of things we're putting on the devil ain't the devil. Well, he'll bring it to pass, but what you open the door for him. I wouldn't open no door for the devil. What did you just say? Don't nothing ever work for me. I ain't got no friends. Don't nobody like me. Everybody's against me. Oh, my goodness. You ain't found that. That's not in your covenant with God. God said he would withhold no good thing. It's his pleasure to give you the kingdom. He'll provide all your needs. See, what we got to understand, we've got a lot more to do with what's going on in our lives than we thought. Because the devil's a defeated foe. You're the one with the power. You're the one with the authority. You're the one that dictates how bright your light shines. Not the devil, not anybody. Look at verse 8. It says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that trusteth in him." We just need to trust God. I trust him. And I'm learning to trust him. Do I trust him as much as I need to? No. But I'm learning. I trust him care more today than I did last year. And I don't trust him more this year than I did last year because everything went right. It's when the things were bad and wrong and he bore me out that my trust grew. It's only in a test that I got a testimony. I listened to Bishop Jakes last night, disruptive thinking. Oh, boy, that was good. He said he don't know why we got this thing that, you know, we're just going to walk through. And when God sends you a problem right behind it. You know, when God opens the door and tell you I'm going to use you mightily, I'm going to use you and send you forth and there, what he said is persecution's coming. Trouble's coming. Glory. But see, we don't hear that part. We don't hear that part. But what he's telling you, even though it's coming, I'm bigger than what you're going through. Amen. Look to me. Trust me. Amen. Psalms 25. Sister Jill, will you come here? I got a handout to go with that one. I was just surfing, and I found this. Oh, Lord. I said, thank you, Jesus. This is so good. I just typed in the Google bar what to do when you don't know what to do, and that came up. Ain't it good? Psalms 25. Go to Psalms 25. That's the one I had. That's not the one on that page, but that's the one I have. What to do when you don't know what to do. Everybody got one? Psalms 25. Chris don't have one. Oh. We're getting one. I got one in the house he can have. He should. Well, you can pick one if you want to. And I had this scripture, and when I put that in Google, what to do when you just to see what would come up. And I already had Psalms 25, verse 4 through 5. And it says, "Show me thy ways, O Lord. Teach me thy paths. Lead me in thy truth and teach me. For thou art the God of my salvation. On thee do I wait all the day." And when I put it up, number one, it says, "Teach me your way." I said, oh, wow. And that was Psalms 86. This is another translation. "Teach me your way, O Lord. I will walk in your truth." Sometimes we just need to be a student. When we ask God to teach us his way, it will expose how much or often we are following our own ways. It's not necessarily that our ways are wrong. It just may be that our ways aren't the best ways. God, our master teacher, will show us his way and help us to walk in his truth. When we become a learner and choose to walk in his truth, it positions us to hear and follow and walk toward the plan God has for us. Isn't that good? It said we just need to be a student. You ask God to teach you his way. It says not necessarily that our way is wrong. It just might not be the best way. And God, who is our master teacher, will show us his way. The second was, show me your purpose. It says, many are the plans in the mind of a man, but it is the purpose of the Lord that will stand. That's Proverbs 19:21. Ultimately, we want what God has purposed for us far more than what we have planned for ourselves, right? That's why when faced with a decision, we seek first God's purpose for us, and then the plan will follow the purpose. As we ask God to show us his purpose for our lives, it will make what was once confusing more clear. Our plans change, but God's purpose does not. Ooh, I thought that was good. Oh, that was yum yum. Our plans change, but God's purpose does not. And we have to know that God moves us in line with his purpose. So sometimes you thought you were going to go this way, but he took you this way. You know, when he bore the children of Israel, he said, I bore you out and I led you to the wilderness to prove to you what was in your own heart. But my purpose all along was to bring you out. When we know why God made us, what is the reason for our existence in the earth? What is it that I am to do? What I am to do, nobody else can do it. Nobody else can do what he set me in here to do. Nobody else can do. There are certain people's lives that God have placed us here on the earth to be the catalyst for change. There's somebody that won't hear anybody's voice but yours. So when we learn what God's purpose is, and all of us have a purpose. Don't you think that you was just here because your mom and dad felt romantic? No. You were a master plan of Almighty God. Every last one of us in this room was sent here with a purpose and a plan. You're not here just to take up space. You're not a mistake. Some people said, well, you know, we didn't plan you. No, but God did. Hey, that's why I'm here. God did. You may not have planned me, but God did. I think you've been doing a real good job. Number three, establish my steps. It says the heart of man plans his ways, but the Lord establishes his steps. Sometimes we just have to make our plans using our best judgment. And we can fully intend to follow through so we'll get what or where we think is best. But when we ask God to establish our steps, we're asking him to determine how that plan unfolds. Ultimately, it is God who controls the implementation of our plans. God is the one who determines the ultimate outcome. As he establishes our steps, he is ordering actions and events in such a way to pull off the best outcome for us. Oh, my. Oh, my. As he established our steps, that's when you make him Lord. He can tell you where to go. He can tell you what to do. He can tell you what to get involved, what to connect with. Do you know how many people are sitting in the wrong church today? Because they won't let him establish their steps. They've allowed the enemy to put in their mind, I ain't going to sit under no white man. I ain't going to sit some people. I ain't going to sit under no black man. I definitely ain't gonna sit under no woman, whether she white, black, Hispanic, I don't care what, if she female, she automatically disqualified. I'm not gonna go to that church because, you know, they don't have all these different things and all that. But have you asked God where you supposed to be? Because wherever you supposed to be, that's where he's sending your food. He ain't gonna reroute it to where you are. He gonna send it to where he told you to be. Because God knows, what does it say? He is ordering actions and events in such a way to pull off the best outcome for us. You and I don't know what's best for us. He does. And he will orchestrate if we allow him. Oh, shandaloko sikarabashita. Ooh, la 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 ma shiko rodea shendele masaya. Praise you, Jesus. Get it in. God, I thank you. You can look at your life and all the things that you've gone through and you've endured. Some was of our own making. But some things had to be to get you to where you are today. If you hadn't gone through that test, you would never have known how strong you are. Glory. He's ordering actions. I can't get away from that. He's ordering actions and events in such a way to pull off the best outcome for us. Well, I was hoping to get that position, but I got passed over. Maybe he knew you needed to be passed over because maybe you had too much pride. Ooh, Jesus. See, we don't like to talk on that side of it. Maybe he knew that if you had moved to that position at that time, you'd have got puffed up, and instead of giving him the glory, it's because you're so smart. Our plans change, but God's purpose does not. See, God has, in his mind, success is written on all of us. Victory is written on all of us. But God knows our hearts, and he knows our minds, and he knows how much pressure needs to be applied. He knows how much fire needs to be applied. Now, he don't use sickness and disease. He don't use death. Those things are of the kingdom of darkness. But sometimes you'll have to stay a little longer somewhere than you thought you'd have to stay. Jesus. He wanted to know if you was willing to humble yourself. If you were willing to go down so he could take you up. Because you know when you went down as you, but when you came up, it was God. And he's going to always get the glory. He's always going to get the glory. See, we can't take no glory for ourselves. It's God. I didn't know serving Pastor Taylor for 18 years, working in lands for 40 years. He was positioning me for the day. You don't know how many times I tried to quit lands. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But he knew I needed to stay there, Tori. He knew I needed to go through everything I went through. I believe it's worked for my good. I believe it's worked for my good. He is ordering actions and events in such a way. Now you got to get this. To pull off the best outcome for us. Go ahead, sister. No, it's okay. Where am I? He bring him one. Thank you, Jesus. Glory.
Every time you read that part about He is ordering actions and events in such a way to pull off the best outcome for us. Like when we're believing the Lord for something and it ain't coming as quick as we think it should come, that's where the trust come in. Yes, because he's behind the scenes pulling off the best outcome for us. So while we wondering why it's taking or going as slow to us, He's over there behind the scene.
Lord.
Ordering actions and events. Action that can people.
Yeah.
Situations, circumstance, events.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. In such a way to pull off
the best
outcome.
See, working for your good. That's what you got to know. He's working for your good. You think that thing working against you, but it's really working for your good. Because you would have never known you needed God till you couldn't do it yourself. How many of us, when we get in that happy place, that good place, you're able to pay your bills, ain't nobody calling you no more. And we take our ease in Zion. But when we get in trouble, you call on God midnight, supper time, noontime, in the morning. You just got to get along with Jesus. You ain't never wanted to get along with Jesus till you get it. Now, when everything going well, you know, and everything, I catch you on the fly, Jesus, but you get in a hard place. God, are you there? Oh, family, I'll see y'all later. I got to go over to the church. Oh, I got to get in the room. Oh, my God, I got to pull out the communion. So what those things are doing is really our faith is being built up and our faith is being increased. I read something somewhere, and I don't really know where it was, and said this person was crying out to God. Said, Lord, said, you got me I'm in the fire. And just it, things are just say, God, don't leave me in the fire too long. Lord, it's hotter than it should be. Say, he told me, say, when I see myself in you. Because, see, God knows the right amount of pressure that needs to be applied. See, we don't. See, we're trying to fix up myself and we'll hurt somebody, possibly kill somebody or whatever. But God knows how much stretching needs to be done. He knows how much pressure needs to be applied. Amen. But why that's happening, what you got to understand is he's ordering actions and events in such a way to pull off the best outcome for you. You thought it was meant to kill you. Now, the enemy did, but this is not talking about the enemy. He's talking about God. You know, as a parent, sometimes our kids want things. And you say, well, no, you're not ready for that. You're not ready for that yet. And they think you're a meanie. Well, you could do it, but you already know your maturity level is not right for that right now. And if I give you that right now, that's not going to be the good. But if I wait another year, and as you show me your maturity, then you're able to do that. But you thought, you thought I was just saying no to be mean or whatever, but I was looking for the best outcome. And when we start looking at God like that, yeah, well, I praise you. Though there be no cattle in the stall, I'm going to praise you, Lord. Look what it says, my friend. Praying God's word is always a good choice that will lead you to greater faith and keep you walking on the path of life. Proverbs 15:24 says, the path of life leads upward for the wise, and we are the wise. Amen. So we're going to cry out to the Lord and ask him to teach us. We're going to stay in the word. When we don't know what to do, we're going to stay in the word. We're going to guard our hearts. We're going to increase our praise and our worship, and we're going to watch our mouth. Amen. And we know that God, our plans are changed, but God's purpose does not. And his purpose is that we prosper and be in health, even as our souls prosper. Amen. Did you receive?